Hello, this is Sana Parveen here, and welcome once again to my YouTube channel, Sana's Biochemistry. As you people know that we have started with a 45 days NEET practice session, and this is day 6 for the session. In these sessions, so we come up with one video every day, and each of our video consists of 15 solved questions from NEET question papers, previous year question papers from biology section. So in this video also, we are going to solve 15 questions, and let us begin without wasting much of time. Okay, so as I said in my last video that I will be discussing this question once again. So we are going to first discuss this question, and then we're going to move with the rest of the questions. If you have not watched the previous videos, I'm going to give you the link in the description below. You can go watch those videos if you want. Let us continue with this video first. Okay, so here in Snapdragon, a red flower was crossed with a white flower, and in F1 generation, pink flowers were obtained. When pink flowers were selfed, the F2 generation showed white, red, and pink flowers. Show the incorrect statement from the following. Okay, so in this question, what is asked is we need to choose an incorrect statement. Option given to us are, this experiment does not follow the principle of dominance. Second option, pink flower in F1 generation is due to incomplete dominance. Third one, ratio of F2 is 1 by 4 red, 2 by 4 pink, 1 by 4 white. And the fourth one here is, law of segregation does not apply in this experiment. Okay, so we are going to understand this experiment entirely by considering the crosses which are involved here. Okay, so in this question, what is given to us is there's a plant, and in this plant species, we've got two type of flowers. One is the red one, okay, and the second one is the white one. And when we cross between them, we end up getting pink color flowers, okay. And then we go for the F2 generation. This one is our F1 generation, and then we're going to go for F2 generation. So we're going to proceed and see the entire cross here. Perfect. For the red one, I am going to take the symbol as color of the flower is red, color of the flower is red. Okay, fine. So I'm going to write little bit, you know, smaller so that we have got much space. Yes. So capital R is the color of red flowers, red color, and the other one is white color flowers. We are doing a cross between them. So whenever crosses happen, we have the formation of gametes. Here, first of all, I am talking about parent 1. These are parent 1. When gametes are produced, we get the gametes to be 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so these are our gametes. When there is gamete formation, when an organism makes gamete, okay, each gamete receives one gene copy. This is very true. So here we've got one gene copy, one gene copy, one gene copy, and one gene copy, okay. And these gene copies are selected randomly. Okay, it's like flipping up a coin, flipping up a coin. Okay, you cannot make out which gene is going to go where. So it is randomly selected. And this is called as law of segregation. Law of segregation. Okay. Then what happens is we need to show the cross. And when I cross, I get my F1 generation is this one, okay, and this is having pink color flowers. When I do the cross of this pink color flowers, these are going to be my parent two. Now I have the combination to be like this, and this is nothing but pink color flowers, okay. And when I cross them, pink color flowers, when I cross them again, now these are parent two, these are going to give us gametes again. So I form the gametes. I don't have space here, so I'm writing it like this. I get the gametes, and when I get the gametes, I go for Punnett square. Punnett square will be somewhat like this. I hope once I'm done shooting this one, everything that I'm writing so minute should be visible. So this is going to be completely red. Okay, so I'm going to write here red. The second one, if I cross people, it is going to come out to be pink because it's a combination of red and white. Second one is again a combination of red and white. So I'm going to write here pink P. And the last one is completely white. Okay, when I see the ratio is going to come out as 1 is to 2 is to 1. That means 1 red, 2 pink, and 1 white. This is, if you compare it with a normal monohybrid cross, we either get a dominant variety or a recessive variety. But here, the law of dominance is not followed. The rule that is followed here is incomplete dominance. Incomplete dominance. Okay, now what is incomplete dominance? That means, this one, this dominant one is not completely masking the recessive one. Okay, if the dominant one is expressing itself, the recessive one is also expressing itself. Okay, the one trait here is not completely masking the other trait. Okay, so if, for example, if I have got, I choose a different color, if I have got one person here and one person here, okay, this one I know is stronger and this one is weaker. When there's a fight going on between, and this one is, you know, bombarding on this one, the second one is fighting back, okay, which is not which does not happen in the normal monohybrid cross. This is not normal monohybrid cross, okay. This is incomplete dominance we're looking at, okay. So when this one is fighting, this one is beating this person, this one is fighting back, okay. That means this one is not completely dominant on this one because the other one is also fighting back, okay. So I hope the cross is clear. If the cross is not clear, comment down in the comment section. I can make that video once again. When I look at the options which are given to us, this experiment does not follow the principle of dominance. Okay, is it that? No, it is going to follow the law of dominance. Okay, I'm extremely sorry. Yes, this statement is obviously true. This experiment does not follow the principle of dominance. Okay, second one is pink color in F1 generation is due to incomplete dominance. Yes, correct. Ratio is going to come out as 1 is to 2 is to 1. Exactly, this is also true. And the last option which is given to us is law of segregation does not apply in this experiment. This statement is wrong and we need to find out the incorrect statement. So the option number 4 is going to be our answer. Option 4, yesterday's question, option 4 is the correct answer. Because in this experiment, law of segregation is absolutely followed. Okay, we have seen this one. Law of segregation is followed. Gametes are completely getting formed with one pair of gene in it. So the correct option is going to be option number 4. Law of segregation does not apply in this experiment. I don't know what I'm speaking. I'm sleep deprived. Okay, no problem. Let us continue with this one. So I hope everyone has understood. And we're going to move to the next question now. Okay. So we have got these questions, in which I will be reading out the questions now. टेक्स वेरी लॉन्ग टाइम फॉर पाइनएप्पल प्लांट्स टू प्रोड्यूस फ्लावर्स. विच कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ हॉर्मोन्स कैन बी अप्लाइड टू आर्टिफिशियली इंड्यूस फ्लावरिंग इन पाइनएप्पल प्लांट्स थ्रू आउट द ईयर टू इंक्रीज द यील्ड? एंड द ऑप्शन गिवन टू अस आर ऑक्सिन एंड इथिलीन, गिबरलिन एंड साइटोकाइनिन, गिबरलिन एंड एब्सिसिक एसिड, साइटोकाइनिन एंड एब्सिसिक एसिड. व्हाट इज द करेक्ट आंसर? एज यूजुअल आई एम गोइंग टू गिव यू 3 seconds एंड देन आई एम गोइंग टू गो फॉर एक्सप्लेनेशन पार्ट. बाय दैट टाइम यू पीपल आर डूइंग इट, आई एम गोइंग टू ग्रैब माय बॉटल. Okay. Correct answer here, people, is auxin and ethylene. Okay, we are here specifically talking about pineapple plant. So these hormones, which are plant hormones called as phytohormones, auxin induces flowering in the pineapple plant. Okay, ethylene is also involved somewhere or the other in flowering, in which ethylene helps in synchronization of flowering. Okay, and then what comes out after flower is the fruit. So flowering synchronization and fruit set up in the pineapple. So I'm going to write here, auxin is going to do what, people? It is going to induce flowering, and ethylene is going to do the synchronization of flowering. Okay, so that is a correct option, option number one. If we talk about the other hormones, people, here, gibberellin is also somewhere or the other involved in flowering, but gibberellin is involved in flowering of Arabidopsis. Okay, it's a plant, Arabidopsis. So gibberellin is also somewhere or the other involved in flowering, but in Arabidopsis. Other functions of gibberellin is it is involved in stem elongation, germination, dormancy, etc., etc. Okay, so we had a discussion about gibberellin. Abscisic acid, when I talk about this one, is involved into, again somewhere or the other, into it includes seed and bud dormancy. Seed and bud dormancy. Okay, so abscisic acid. And the last one, cytokinin, is again somewhere or the other involved in flowering, but in a different flower or in a different plant called as Oryza. Okay, so got it? As I specifically talking about pineapple plant here, we are going to consider the option number one to be correct, because here we're talking about auxin and ethylene, which are specifically for flowering into pineapple plant. Rest, gibberellin, yes, I agree that it is involved into a flowering but in Arabidopsis. Cytokinin, again in flowering but in Oryza plant. Abscisic acid is involved in seed and bud dormancy. Another function of gibberellin, other function of gibberellin is to, it has got an involvement into stem elongation, germination, dormancy. Okay, we are going to move on with the next question here. Identify the cells whose secretion protects the lining of gastrointestinal tract from various enzymes. I'm going to repeat the question. Identify the cells whose secretion promotes the lining of gastrointestinal tract from various enzymes. Option given to us are chief cells, goblet cells, oxyntic cells, duodenal cells. Okay. And the answer here to our question is goblet cells. Okay, the correct answer is goblet cells. When I talk about goblet cell, its function is to secrete mucin. Every time I select a blue color, I end up selecting a green color. I don't know what is the problem. A goblet cell is involved into secretion of mucin, and it create a protective mucus layer, and it is going to produce a protective mucus layer. Mucin is secreted by a goblet cell. Okay, now goblet cells are involved in protection, lubrication of what? Of epithelial surfaces of the respiratory and digestive tracts by producing mucus. So function of goblet cell is involved into protection by secretion of mucus layer, by secreting mucin, and it is present in the epithelial layers of the respiratory and the digestive tracts. Okay, I hope you people are able to follow me. Also, goblet cells are involved into bicarbonate synthesis, and then as the mucosal epithelium is formed there in the gastrointestinal tract, and there is a concentrated acid which is present in the stomach HCl, and therefore the goblet cells are able to protect the lining of the stomach, and the stomach will not, end up having holes inside of it. If you talk with the other cells here, people, chief cells or peptic cells, chief cells or peptic cells, they are involved into production of an enzyme called as pepsin. Okay, so PC, Priyanka Chopra, PC is what people here, I know, bad joke, but yeah, not a joke, but your way of remembering. PC, pepsin synthesized by chief cell. Chief cells are also called as peptic cells. Okay, PP, peptic cells. Goblet cells, we already had a discussion about that. The next one here is called as oxyntic cells, which are also called as parietal cells, people. Parietal cells. Okay, and what is the function? Is to secrete HCl. Is to secrete HCl. And the last one is duodenal cell, which is definitely present where? In the duodenum. And as it is the part of the duodenum, that is the starting of the stomach, the starting of the small intestine, the starting of the intestine, okay, the starting of the intestine and the ending of the stomach, that region is called as duodenum. And the function of duodenum is involved into water and nutrient absorption. They're going to involve, as it is part of intestine, it is involved in absorption. Okay, so our correct answer is going to be goblet cells, which secretes mucus layer. Identify the cell whose secretion protects the lining of gastrointestinal tract from various enzymes. So who's going to do that? It is done by our goblet cells. Okay, let us just move on ahead. The next question. Perfect. We have got this question. Which of the following can be used as a biocontrol agent in the treatment of plant disease? Option given to us are Trichoderma, Chlorella, Anabina, Lactobacillus. Okay, people, Lactobacillus is my favorite. I have given you time for answering the question. Analyze yourself. Otherwise, you people are thinking, what time pass am I doing? No, it's your time I've given. Answer here comes out to be Trichoderma. Is the correct answer Trichoderma? Okay, first of all, I'm going to explain what are biocontrol agent. Biocontrol agent are, we use biological entities for control. Okay, what kind of control? Example, if I have BT cotton. Okay, cotton plant needs protection from bollworm. Cotton plant needs protection from bollworm. So I am going to use a bacteria called as Bacillus thuringiensis, which is going to act like a biological control, okay, which will act like a biocontrol agent. This Bacillus thuringiensis is going to act like a biocontrol agent who is going to control the growth of bollworm. Okay, who's controlling the growth of bollworm, people? The Bacillus thuringiensis. Okay, who needs protection? Cotton needs protection. Okay, so these are called as biological entities. I'm going to repeat here. Cotton plant is eaten by bollworm. Okay, I don't want, I'm a farmer. Okay, I am a farmer here standing. As I'm a farmer, I don't want my cotton to be spoiled. I need help. Okay. I go and seek help from one type of bacteria called as Bacillus thuringiensis. Okay. Bacillus thuringiensis has some kind of toxin in its body and this toxin kills the bollworm. Okay. So I am going to incorporate that toxin into my cotton, making it BT cotton. Okay. BT cotton. And this BT cotton, when bollworm is going to come and now eat the cotton, is going to die. Okay. So Bacillus thuringiensis here acted like a biocontrol agent. Okay. Next thing when I talk about is, so we have got here, which of the following can be used as a biocontrol agent in the treatment of plant disease? Trichoderma, Chlorella, Anabina, Lactobacillus. Answer here I've given you as Trichoderma. Okay, Trichoderma is itself a fungus and controls the growth of other fungus. One fungus, okay, this is fungus, Trichoderma, controlling the growth of other fungus. Okay, so this one is our biocontrol agent, the king. Okay, I hope everyone is understanding. Next, Lactobacillus involved in making curd. Next question from plant physiology. Phloem and gymnosperms lack. What do they lack? Phloem and gymnosperms lack albuminous cells and sieve cells. Second option, sieve tubes only. Third option, companion cells only. And the fourth option, people, here is both sieve tubes and companion cells. Correct answer is both sieve tubes and companion cells. Both sieve tubes and companion cells are kind of absent in phloem in gymnosperms. Okay, it's a direct question. I don't know what to explain in this. There's no explanation in it. So we're going to move and jump on to the next question. One thing which I want to specify is we have got sieve cells and sieve tubes. Okay, we are talking about phloem in gymnosperms. Phloem in gymnosperm is going to have sieve cells, is going to have sieve cells, I'm repeating, but it is not going to have sieve tubes. Okay, sieve tubes are not there, people. Make a point, sieve tubes are not there, people. Sieve tubes are present in angiosperms, okay, the flowering plants, if I talk about that. So both sieve tubes and companion cells. Next question. Okay, just give me a second. Yes, let us just move on ahead. Extrusion of a second polar body from egg nucleus occurs when? Options are after entry of sperm but before fertilization. Second one, after fertilization. Third one, before entry of sperm into ovum. Last one, simultaneously with first cleavage. I read the question. We're gonna go slow, okay? Because this is human physiology and I'm in love with human physiology. Extrusion of a second polar body from egg nucleus occurs when? Okay, answer I'm going to tell you for this one comes out to be after entry of sperm but before fertilization. That means the sperm has already entered but the fertilization has not occurred yet. Okay, we're going to understand what is polar body. And we are also going to understand what is this extrusion process for which I will be needing some space. Perfect. Okay, so polar body, when I talk about that one, polar body is happening during the time of female gametogenesis. Okay, female gametogenesis means people what? Means egg formation. Okay, we females, we in our body have got what? We have got egg in our body. Okay, so egg formation. I know my drawing is kind of good. When we move on ahead, okay, for the formation of egg, we have got meiosis division. Meiosis division. Okay. It is going to be of two types. It is going to be meiotic first and meiotic second. Meiotic first division and meiotic second division. Okay. Now we look at the cell. Okay. This is the cell in the female's body. This cell undergoes meiotic first division. When it undergoes meiotic first division, it is going to undergo unequal division. Okay, unequal division, that means the chromosome numbers are okay, fine. Chromosome numbers are okay. But the thing that is unequally divided is the cytoplasm. Unequally divided is what people? The cytoplasm. Okay, and the one that receives less of cytoplasm forms a polar body. Okay, forms a polar body. Okay, fine. So when this is going to divide further, we are going to get one cell and we are going to get first polar body. First polar body. Okay, fine. Next thing what happens is this is going to undergo division. It is going to undergo meiotic second division. Meiotic second division. Then it is going to form the egg, that is n number of chromosome, and we are going to get our second polar body. Second polar body. Okay, fine. So when is the egg formation happening or when is the second polar body extrusion happening? Okay, for this we again need to see the diagrammatic representation. This is our secondary oocyte. Secondary oocyte. I'm not calling it to be the egg, secondary oocyte. And secondary oocyte is the queen, which is surrounded by many cells. This is the queen. It is surrounded by many cells. Now the teeny tiny sperm is going to come inside. Okay, it is traveling because, see, I told you now, every time I select a blue color, it comes out to be green. Okay, so this teeny tiny sperm is coming in. And when it is touching... When it is touching the secondary oocyte, then we have got the formation of the polar body. Then the polar body comes out, okay? It has just touched, the sperm has just touched the secondary oocyte, and then the division is going to take place with the division forming the polar body, which is going to be released out. Okay, the chromosomes have not yet... The chromosomes have not yet combined. The fertilization has not taken place yet. Okay, because fertilization is what? Combination of both of them forming zygote and the genetic material here and here combined in the zygote. So fertilization has not taken place yet. Okay, it is just the sperm has got the entry inside. Okay, but the fertilization has not occurred yet, and that time the polar body is pushed out, which is called as extrusion. We move back to our question, and then we look at the question once again. Extrusion of second polar body from egg nucleus occurs when? After entry of sperm, but before fertilization. So my correct answer is this one. Okay, next question, we move on to that one. Okay. Yep. Question number six. Under which of the following conditions will there be no change in reading frame of the following mRNA? mRNA, for those who don't know, is messenger RNA. RNA are of various different types: mRNA, tRNA, rRNA, messenger RNA, transfer RNA, and ribosomal RNA, and other RNAs as well, but we're not going to discuss that one. Okay, we need to focus on the question. Under which of the following conditions will there be no change in the reading frame of the following mRNA? This is the mRNA which is given to us, and the option given to us are insertion of G at fifth position, deletion of G from fifth position, insertion of A and G at fourth and fifth position respectively. And the fourth one is deletion of GGU from seventh, eighth, ninth, and position. Ninth position. Okay. GGU made me, felt like as if I'm pronouncing Gigi Hadid. GGU. Okay. Moving on to this frame, the first one, the first option if I see is insertion of G at fifth position. First, second, third, fourth, fifth. Okay, if I insert a G here, I am inserting a G here. Okay, reading frame people is what? I have A, A, C, A, G, G, C, G. Okay, we read the message on the RNA in a combination of three. Okay, A, A, C, A, G, C, G. G C G G U. Okay, I read it in a pair of three. So, for example, I'm read when I read it in a pair of three, I come out with 3 1 say bed. Okay, next three say red. Next three say blue. No, not blue sky. Because three. Okay, when I insert a G here in between G and C. When I insert a G here, the reading frame will get affected. Okay, the reading frame is going to get affected because I am inserting this G here. I am inserting this G here. Okay, but red is for AGC. Red is for AGC. When I insert a G here, it will be AGG. Okay, which will affect my reading frame. Okay, now how will I be reading it? I will be reading it in a different way. This frame will not again be there because AGC was for red. AGG will not be for red. Okay. The same thing as option number two. Deletion of G from fifth position. We want no change in the reading frame. Okay. So insertion of something and deletion of something is definitely going to affect our reading frame. Okay. This question, entire video we can make on this one. Okay. But let us just not move into much of detail. We're just going to look answer. If you're not understanding, comment down. We can take care of that. Okay, so feel free to comment. Insertion of A and G at fourth and fifth position respectively. Yes, it is going to affect the reading frame. So this is not going to be the answer. Okay. Okay, people, I'm just going to tell you what it is. Now, see here. More 5 minutes, but that's okay. A C A G C G G U G C U A U U. Okay, this is my mRNA given to me. I select three, next three, next three, next three, and next three. Okay, for these B E D R E D S K Y C A T D O G. Okay, this is my reading frame. What is the reading frame? Bed, red, sky, cat, dog. Okay, once I insert a G here, once I insert a G here, what is now going to happen? It is going to shift the entire reading frame. It is like inserting an alphabet here. It is like inserting an alphabet here, that is say E. For G, we have an alphabet E. So when I insert, my reading frame is affected. Now the reading frame is going to be BED, REE, because E is being inserted. Then the entire reading frame is going to be DSK in a pair of three. People in a pair of three. BED, REE, now this one, now this, this, this. Okay, so DSK, YCA, TDO, my reading frame is messed up now. Okay, reading frame is messed up now. So inserting anything or deleting anything is going to affect my reading frame. Okay, now in the last option which is given to us, A A C A G C G G U G C U A U U. Okay, I've by hearted that. The last option which is given to us is, what if I delete this one? What if I completely delete this one? What I took was, I took here to be the reading frame that was, what was that? Bed, red, sky, cat, and dog. Now in the fourth option which is given to us, I have deleted this one entirely. GGU is like completely, you know, we've removed that. When I remove that completely, I get BED, RED, CAT, DOG. My reading frame has not been affected now, because entire thing is removed out. Okay, entire thing is removed out, so the reading frame is now not messed up. Okay, so my option, correct option is going to be what, people? Deletion of GGU from 7th, 8th and 9th position is not going to have any change on the reading frame. Got it? Okay. Next question, we move on to that. The concept of omnis cellula e cellula regarding cell division was first proposed by Virchow, Schwann, Schleiden, Aristotle. Okay, a very simple question. Even a 6th standard, 7th standard nowadays people are going to know the answer to this one. And the answer is going to come out as Virchow. Okay, he was the scientist and he gave this statement called as omnis cellula e cellula, which means every cell stems from another cell. Every cell stems from another cell. Okay. The concept of omnis cellula e cellula is every cell stems from another cell was given by Virchow. And these two scientists gave us cell theory. And there was modification done by Virchow in the cell theory. Okay, we're not going to talk about Aristotle in this case. Moving on with the next question. And the question is in front of you on the screen, which I'm going to read it out. What triggers activation of protoxin to active BT toxin of Bacillus thuringiensis in boll worm? Okay, this is what I was saying. Let us just consider there is this cotton tree, and in that we have inserted the toxin from Bacillus thuringiensis. And this Bacillus thuringiensis, the toxin which is produced in the plant is in the inactive form. Protoxin is the inactive form of toxin. Okay. And it is converted to active form. Inactive form of the toxin is activated in the body of the bollworm, in the body of the insect that has come up to eat. Eat what, people? Come up to eat our cotton. Okay. It has come up to eat our cotton, and in that we have got the toxin from Bacillus thuringiensis. In the inactive foramen plant, the moment this inactive toxin enters into the ball worm, it is activated because of what factors? Option given to us are body temperature, moist surface of midgut, alkaline pH of gut, acidic pH of stomach. 3 seconds. Okay, answer to this question is alkaline pH of the gut. Okay, there is basic pH in the gut of the ball worm, and the moment the protoxin enters into the ball worm, it is getting activated in presence of acidic and in presence of alkaline pH of the gut of the ball worm. Okay, fine. And one more thing which I wanted to tell you people is when the bacteria produces the toxin, it is from cry protein. Okay, CRY, cry. So crystal protein, cry protein. Okay, the cry gene is taken from Bacillus thuringiensis and it is inserted into the inserted into the plant. Okay, next question, we move on. Perfect. Next question is, yeah. Identify the correct pair representing the causative agent of thyroid fever and the confirmatory test for thyroid. Okay. Thyroid is a disease. It's a condition. And what is the causative agent? Who is going to cause thyroid? And how are we going to do the confirmatory test? What is the name of the confirmatory test? Okay. So, yeah. Option given to us are Plasmodium vivax UTI test, Streptococcus pneumoniae Vidal test, Salmonella typhi Anthron test, Salmonella typhi Vidal test. Okay. I'm going to tell you the answer. Answer to this question is... Salmonella typhi and Vidal test. Salmonella typhi is a bacteria. It's a virulent bacteria. It's a harmful bacteria that is going to cause typhoid fever. Salmonella typhi. Okay, this one is a bacteria. And what is the test, the confirmatory test to say that the person is suffering from typhoid is a Vidal test. Okay. It is going to check, keep a check whether the person is suffering from typhoid fever or not. Anthron test people is for carbohydrates. So here the causative agent is correct. In option number C, causative agent is correct, but the test is not correct. The test is, the test which is given, Anthron test is for carbohydrates, so carbs. Okay, so option number 4th is the correct option. Moving on to the next question. Yes, what is a genetic disorder in which an individual has an overall masculine development? What is the genetic disorder in which an individual has an overall masculine development? Gynecomastia, and is sterile. Options are Turner syndrome, Klinefelter syndrome, Edwards syndrome, Downs syndrome. Okay. Answer here is Klinefelter syndrome is the correct answer. Okay. Now what happens in here? If there's an individual that is suffering from a genetic disorder, that means there is something going messed up. Okay, the genes are messed up. Okay, the chromosomes are messed up here. It is involving here trisomy of sex chromosome. Trisomy of sex chromosomes. So, see, we people, we know that there are 46 chromosomes, out of which
44 are autosomes and 2 are sex chromosomes. Okay, so I can write here 2 can be X and Y, or it can be X and X. Here, as we're talking about masculine, that means we're talking males here. And in males, we have got the combination to be 44, which are the autosomes, plus 2, that is XY, which are the sex chromosomes. Okay. There is trisomy of the sex chromosome. Trisomy means 3. There is an insertion of 1 extra X chromosome. Okay, there is an additional X chromosome. Okay, as there is an additional X chromosome here, the person who is suffering from trisomy has got a combination of 44 plus X plus X plus Y, starts to suffer from Klinefelter syndrome and has got gynecomastia. What is gynecomastia, people? I'm going to make some space here. Gynecomastia is enlargement of a man's breasts, okay? Usually due to what? Hormone imbalance, okay? So here it is enlargement of man's breast, okay? Why? Because there is something going wrong with the hormones. There is hormonal imbalance in the person. It is because testosterone is produced less, okay, because of which the man's breasts are growing big, and this condition is called as gynecomastia. Okay, masculine development, gynecomastia, and is sterile, not able to produce babies. So the option here given to us is Klinefelter syndrome is the correct answer. Then we move on to the next question. This was question number 10. Next question, people, is polyblend. Every time I forget to select a highlighter. Polyblend, a fine powder of recycled modified plastic, has proven to be a good material for making plastic sacks, use as a fertilizer, construction of roads, making tubes and pipes. Correct option. Is construction of roads. Okay. What is polyblend? It is polymer blend. Polymer blend. Okay. Polymer blend, we take at least two polymers having different physical property, we're trying to mix them up. Okay, two polymers, we're trying to mix them up, at least two polymers, and then we get a poly blend. And this is used to lay roads which have increased road life. Okay, increased road life, if you want, you need to have construction of roads done by poly blend. Okay, because if it's a rainy season, in rainy seasons, in that season, the condition of the roads are like kind of horrible, like literally horrible. And if you're driving a two-wheeler, your back is going to pain. Okay, two-wheeler back pain if there are potholes in the road. Okay, so we better be using poly blend. Moving on. Next question. Nuclear waste. Question from nuclear chemistry. Which of the following methods is the most suitable for disposal of nuclear waste? What are you going to do if you want to dispose nuclear waste? If you're working with nuclear chemistry in that field, shoot the... See, I told I forget to take a highlighter. Shoot the waste into space. Oh my god. Bury the waste under Antarctic Ocean cover. Dump the waste within rocks under deep ocean. Bury the waste within rock deep below the earth's surface. Correct answer is bury the waste within rocks deep below the earth's surface. Okay, because it is kind of poisonous. It is going to emit out radiation, so you cannot dispose it anywhere and everywhere. Okay. Because it is going to cause a hell lot of harm to us. So it is better be shielded and then buried. Okay. So the answer comes out to bury the waste within rocks deep below the earth's surface. Okay, next question. We're going to look at that one. Okay. I'm going to read out the question. Match the following hormones with the respective disease. Hormones and diseases is. Initially, when I was in 12th, I used to pronounce that as hormones. But then my teacher told it's not hormones, son, it's hormones. Okay, she scolded me badly. But yeah, insulin, thyroxine, corticoids, growth hormone, Addison's disease, diabetes insipidus, acromegaly, goiter, diabetes mellitus. We need to match. One, now everyone might have done that. Insulin, fatafat, matching it with diabetes mellitus. Okay, diabetes insipidus, this one, diabetes insipidus is something in which our body cannot regulate how to handle fluids in our body. Okay, so as the body is not able to handle the fluid, it is not able to regulate the body fluid, we experience extreme thirst and frequent urination and heavy urination. Okay, getting up at night and urinating, or even bedwetting if you don't have that much of control. So, sorry. It is diabetes insipidus is something in your body not okay with the body fluids. Body cannot regulate how it handles the fluid. So insulin is diabetes insipidus, which we call sugar. Okay, in layman language. Thyroxine, everyone, goiter. Corticoids. Corticoids is related to Addison's disease. Okay, what is Addison's disease? In this, the adrenal gland, which is also called as the cap of the kidneys, adrenal gland. So if I draw the kidney here, bean shape, adrenal gland sits here like a cap to the kidney. Okay, and then the kidneys are kind of happy because it has got caps. So these are adrenal gland people. Adrenal gland. Adrenal glands. Okay, so yeah, so adrenal gland do not produce enough steroid hormones. So these adrenal glands, if they do not synthesize enough steroid hormones, not much steroids are produced. So the person starts to suffer from Addison's disease. And then you have the growth hormone, which is called as acromegaly. Acromegaly, if a person is suffering from acromegaly, the person turns out to be giant. Okay, the person turns out to be giant. Acromegaly, giant person. And in acromegaly, you will see that the hands are growing big in size. Bones are, see, first of all, bones are going to grow big in size, then the body is going to grow big in size, including the hand, feet, and even the face. Okay, and acromegaly usually affects middle-aged adults. So when I look at the options and I match them, I think A we've got five, A we've got five. Okay, this one and this one. A we've got five, B we have got four. Four. So this is the correct option. Option number three is the correct option. Okay. And next question. Select the correct option. We need to select the correct option, and the option given to us are 8th, 9th, and 10th pairs of rib articulate directly within the sternum. 11th and 12th pair of ribs are connected to the sternum with the help of hyaline cartilage. Each rib is a flat, thin bone, and all the ribs are connected dorsally to the thoracic vertebrae and ventrally to the sternum. The last one is there are seven pairs of vertebrosternal, three pairs of vertebrochondral, and two pairs of vertebral ribs. So we need to select the correct option. It's a very direct question. Human physiology, not much of explanation in this one. I'm going to tell you the answer is option number four. Okay, this is the correct answer. not much of explanation in this one. And moving on to the next question. Oh, we're done with the questions. And thank you for those who have made up till the end. If you have really understood the video, hit the like button. If you haven't subscribed to the channel yet, subscribe to the channel. Share it with your friends. Okay, so that the content is getting circulated to as many people as possible. And I think that it is going to be I know it's going to be beneficial to the students, all the people are preparing for NEET examination. We're done for the day. I'm going to end the video now. Hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, and I'm going to hit the bed. Okay, so meet you tomorrow. See you tomorrow in the next video. Fine. Bye bye, everyone. Take care. Stay at your homes. Take care of yourself. Take care of your adults, especially people suffering from diabetes, especially people from old age. Take care of them. And the corona is not yet over. The country has raised the lockdown, not because the disease, the pandemic is over, only because, fine, I don't want to comment. Let us just end the session here. Bye-bye. Take care. See you in the next video. Don't forget to come to the channel for the next video. Okay? Here. Bye-bye. Take care.